Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for joining tonight. We have a great crowd online and a great crowd, small in number, mighty in spirit here in person. I want to thank Dr. Stadlin for initiating this shiur to commemorate the shloshim of Heber Tendler Zatzal. Dr. Stadlin will share more about his, I'm sure, about his life and his bio. I just want to say personally that Rabbi Tendler was very, very helpful to me in a very difficult case. And I was going around trying to get help with this case and no one would help. It was one of those things that there was a halachic way, but no one wanted to be the brave one to take it. And Rabbi Avi Weiss was like, call Rabbi Tendler. And I called Rabbi Tendler and he took the bold and appropriate halachic move to really help someone in need. And I'll never forget his combination of insight and brilliance and sensitivity and boldness and originality and thinking, and it really made a big impact on me. And so I'm personally grateful to him and to you for commemorating him. And there's no better person to talk about Dr. Tendler than Rabbi Tendler than Dr. Stadlin, who is really a world leader in thinking about these issues of brain death, halachic brain death, who's doing advanced research in this topic, and who is really such an important part of a conversation, which is a life or death conversation, and it's critical that we have. And his work is life altering in good ways for our community. And it's he's following the path of Rabbi Dr. Tendler and taking it farther. And we're just really appreciative of you for sharing his Torah and your Torah with us here tonight. And it's an honor to have you doing this for us. Thank you.
Thank you, Rabbi, for the introduction. Thank you, everyone, for being here. And welcome, everyone, on Zoom. Rav Tendler died about 30 days ago, so it's appropriate to discuss his Torah on the Shloshim 30 days after his death. I actually never met Rav Tendler. I called him once, probably about 7-8 years ago. I received his number. I called him. I tried to find a time late in the afternoon. I figured he'd be free. He answered the phone. I introduced myself, and he said, "Is this an emergency?" I said, "No." He said, "I'm teaching a shiur. I'll get back to you. Call me later." And unfortunately, I never got back to him. But I was very impressed that somebody had absolutely no idea who I was. He was willing to, if it was an emergency, and obviously he had emergencies, people talked to him all the time about emergencies, he was willing to take the time away from the shiurim, his teaching, to talk to somebody he knew nothing about. And that really spoke wonders about him. At around this time, when I'm giving other lectures, I have to give disclosures about my financial involvements in any devices that I might be talking about. I obviously don't have any financial interest in this. I was for many years a proud member of the board of the Halachic Organ Donation Society, and I'm still a big supporter. And I also, especially when I was a resident, declared many patients dead due to neurologic criteria, what we usually call brain death. And they, in fact, went on to donated organs, hearts. And so if Rav Tendler, Rav Moshe Feinstein are incorrect about this, then I've murdered people. I don't say this lightly and not for effect. It's to show you that this is a matter of life and death for many people. And when we see Rav Tendler speaking sharply about people who have different views or he feels are misconstruing his views, it's not necessarily because of him or a person, but the severity of the and importance of the issue that we're talking about. So a brief biography of Rav Tendler. He was born in 1926. He graduated from NYU in 1947. He received a smicha in 1949 from Reitz, a master's in 1950, and a PhD in microbiology from Columbia. And he was rabbi of the community synagogue of Muncie for many years. And he taught at YU Reitz for many years. He was president of the Association of Orthodox Jewish Scientists for 2 years. This actually spoke a lot to me about Rav Tendler. When I was growing up in the 70s, 80s, outside of New York, Yeshiva University for me was this bastion of science and Torah. My father, Alva Shalom, was a neuropathologist, but also was very involved in ethics. My mother was she should live long. I was very involved in medical ethics. And Rav Tendler was like the superstar, the kind of the model of what you could accomplish with science and Torah, putting them together. And so this was one of the reasons that I wanted to give this year, and because he was really was a role model of what we could accomplish. And he was a kind of a symbol of a time when there really wasn't a conflict between science and Torah, and people love Torah, love science, and harmonize them. And he was a symbol of this. And he was also the posek for the medical arm of the Association of Orthodox Jewish Scientists. At one time, there were 2,000 members of this organization. So in researching Rav Tendler, I found this quote. He published an article in the Journal of the American Medical Association in the 1970s, and still now it's one of the premier medical journals. He published an article in it. There was later on a back and forth in the letters to the editor between Rav Aaron Soloveitchik and Rav Tendler. And later on in the letters to the editor, there was a neonatologist, a kind of a fundamentalist Catholic neonatologist who rejected the Pope's teachings on brain death. The Pope had said that brain death was death. He rejected it and he criticized Rav Tendler. So in response, another letter to the editor from 1980, Rav Tendler wrote, "The reliance of traditional Torah law on the laws of science to make its rulings is the result of the Jewish definition of monotheism that declares total identity between the God that gave us the laws of nature and the God that gave us his ethical principles on Mount Sinai." So I thought this was a great statement of how science and Torah, science and halacha, are seamless, and they contribute one to each other. It's not a conflict that people see. It's just all one part of God's world. Of course, Rav Tendler being Rav Tendler, he added at the bottom, "Regrettably, too many have become spokesmen for the Orthodox Jewish position, despite their unfamiliarity with God's natural laws or his rules for human conduct, or both." So that was Rav Tendler. When we look at positions on definitions of death, we have to look at them in a number of different contexts. So one is societal context, and what I talked about a little bit about the positive view of science, which was something that Rav Tendler represented, but there's also specific cultural understandings, there's scientific understandings, and so you can't retroject a certain understanding on a position when it wasn't developed in that context, because it's anachronistic and you wind up with results that just don't make sense. So part of what I want to do is identify, when we go through some of these positions, what were the underlying assumptions that were going on, and what was the status of medical science, what was the status of philosophical understandings of death and of human function at the times that these Piskei Halakha were given. So definitions of death, in my opinion, and I think a review of how things have changed over time, they change, and there's a balance between a concept of what a religion or a philosophical approach thinks is death and then what scientific facts show. And so it's kind of a dance back and forth between science and concepts, and eventually you kind of reach a median, or some people would say it's kind of like an asymptotic approach, but it's a back and forth between what science can accomplish and what halacha wants to say. So for example, if you think about defining death, you could come from a halachic point of view and say, this is what halachic says is death, or you could say this is what halacha says is death, and then say, okay, let's find some tests and scientific criteria that will fit with that. Or you can say, here's what science can show in a person, is this death or not? So you can come from either side. And so scientific findings trigger reevaluation. So for example, Rav J. David Bleich, who's written tremendously on medical ethics in 1973, wrote that the definition of death is the cessation of respiration and circulation, which fit with the scientific paradigm at that time. 16 years later, in 1989, he wrote that death is the cessation of vital motion. The term vital motion doesn't show up in the 1973 paper, except in a footnote referring to Black's Law Dictionary. And so something changed between 1973 and 1989. And I don't know Rob Bleich personally, but what changed in the medical community is that we had artificial hearts, we had heart transplantation, and it became very clear that circulation by itself could not be a criterion for life and death. You could put a pump into a body that everyone agrees is dead, and you could have circulation, but everybody would still agree that they're dead. And so circulation doesn't mean life or death by 1989. And so Ralph Blech changed his position in response to scientific facts, and there's nothing wrong about that. Okay, so I'm going to try to keep the anatomy to a minimum, but essentially in discussing definitions of death, we have to know a few things. One is that the heart beats on its own. So some people have done biology experiments that take a frog's heart out and you can put chemicals on it and it'll beat. So the heart will beat on its own as long as it receives some oxygen and blood supply. I think my brother is on the Zoom conference, who's a cardiothoracic surgeon. He has vascularized hearts, and so he can testify to that. The heart is going to be on its own. The brain, though, makes the diaphragm move. So if the brain is irreversibly damaged, then breathing stops unless there's a breathing machine. And so breathing is dependent on the brain. Heart is pretty much goes on by itself until it no longer has the oxygen and glucose and energy to function. Okay, and then without oxygenated blood, if the heart stops, then blood flow stops to the body and different organs will stop functioning at different times and will decay at different times. And that's just a normal observation of how organs in the body function. So when we're looking at these halakhic sources or statements, we want to examine two different competing or different approaches. One is, what is the concept? In other words, a concept is life is this. Life is heart function. Life is brain function. Life is something else. And also criterion. What tests do I need to do and what results do I need to find in order to decide that something that I'm looking at is alive or dead? And those are two very different things. And sometimes it's hard to know for sure which one the author is talking about. And that leads to some problems in understanding. Okay. Prior to artificial hearts, prior to transplantations, prior to ventilators, we could make an assumption that the cessation of one function organ meant that the entire body stopped. So if the heart stopped, everything else stopped. There was no way to replace that. There was no way to preserve that. Similarly, if the breathing stopped, everything else stopped also. But then we had artificial respiration with ventilators, artificial circulation, and this myth of body unity, that everything will function all together and one thing makes everything else stop, is shattered. And in the news recently, I don't know if anybody saw it, I get these things, people send me these articles. There was an experimental kidney that was grown in a pig that was attached to a human being and it functioned. And so this is the first time or one of the first times that a genetically altered kidney that was grown in a pig functioned in a human being. This has great implications for organ restoration. We might not even need transplants if this becomes good technology. But this shows that organs can function without the rest of the body. Once we discard this myth of total body unity, we have to decide what parts of the body are important for life. So with total body unity, any one organ or any couple organs can be the definition of life and death. But when you can preserve a heart by itself, a lung by itself, a brain by itself, different parts of the body by itself, we have to decide which ones are integral and important or and crucial for life and which ones aren't. So essentially, people who mention circulation as a definition of death, that that's their concept of death, basically they are either ignoring modern technology or they're relying on this already disproven myth of body unity. Okay, and ultimately, once we get rid of this myth of body unity, we have to decide what anatomy and what function define a human body, and that's the task that was faced by Rav Moshe Feinstein, Rav Tendler, and many others in the late 1960s on forward. So as an example, these are two papers written right before 1968, which is when kind of the whole idea exploded. We'll get to that in a second. But Dr. Fred Rosner, who basically has translated almost every important medical book and article and has written tremendous amounts, Fred Rosner, one of his first articles in Tradition Magazine Journal, wrote that the most Talmudic and post-Talmudic sages agree that the absence of spontaneous respiration is the only sign needed to ascertain death. And this is under the assumption that we didn't have ventilators. He goes on to discuss ventilators, but before ventilators, if somebody wasn't breathing and you knew they weren't going to breathe anymore, done. And this, similarly, some of the first tshuvot on heart transplants, Rav Weiss and Rav Eliezer Waldenberg, wrote that we need cessation of heartbeat as well and circulation as well as breathing. And so these are two different approaches, but they both are dependent on looking at the body as kind of a unitary whole. So what changed? The idea about whether the cessation of brain function was death started in the 1959 with some French neurologists, but it really hit the mainstream in 1968 when a group of multidisciplinary group at Harvard University published what's commonly called the Harvard Criteria. And essentially what they wanted to do was define a permanently non-functioning brain. And basically they put forward tests that could be done. And essentially they said that if we find that a brain is no longer functioning, we test for all these brainstem reflexes, we find that they're not breathing. And if we do some tests, and the only test that they had at that time was angiograms, which was they could inject blood, a marker, a contrast dye into an artery and then see if the blood flow went to the brain. And so they saw that on these angiograms that there was no blood flow to the brain, and there's also an EEG, which measured brain waves, and they found that there was no brain activity. So they decided and recommended that with a flat EEG, no brain activity, and no blood flow, that a person should be considered dead. And this idea was that the entire brain, every single function of the brain had to be dead in order for the person to be considered dead. At the same time, there was another view that just the brainstem. The brainstem is where consciousness lives, it's where respiration lives, and basically the brainstem is the on-off switch for the entire brain. And the second idea was that the cessation of brainstem activity was the definition of death. And so in the early days, essentially, there were a couple of different concepts of why a non-functioning brain should be dead. One was whole brain. Everything had to be dead, every single cell. One was just the brainstem, because without the brainstem, there was no function, even though other parts of the brain could still have some life activity. And another one, which basically got rejected by pretty much everybody in the halakha community, was cerebral death, which means that consciousness. So the two cerebral hemispheres control consciousness. And so the idea there was that if you're unconscious, that if you're permanently unconscious, you should be considered dead, even though you might be breathing or you might have other functions. So that pretty much got rejected. So that was what's going on in the bioethical committee world. In the halakhic world, there was loss of breathing, which has always been considered a prime candidate for definition of death, but also decapitation, that there's a Mishnah in Ahalot that states that if a decapitated person or animal is considered dead, and then you have to decide what part of decapitation is the real important part. Is it the separation from the neck? Is it that there's no blood flow to the brain? Is it that everything is already, every cell in the brain is died? So it's important to try to figure out, if we're using that paradigm, what exactly it means. And also there's hybrids, which we're gonna see is what Reb Moshe felt. And that's taking the loss of consciousness and adding it to it something else. So for example, there's a Gemara in Gittin that says that someone whose throat is slit can still motion to divorce his wife, which implies that anybody with consciousness is still considered alive, because if you're dead, you can't divorce your wife. As we go on, we're going to see that there was a great impetus to try to identify definitions of brain-related death, but the opponents of brain-related death didn't really seem to come up with a lot of other options on their own, except circulation's important. Okay. So the first attempt to define brain-related death was in 1970. And Rob Gedalia Rabinovich and Dr. Mordechai Konigsberg, who's from here from Chicago, wrote in Hadarom the first article that suggested that cessation of brain function should be considered death. And there was also a paper from Rav Shlomo Goren later on in the 1970s. But what we were going to see is that this was taken in a different direction by Rav Moshe Feinstein. And before I present to you what Rav Moshe said and what Rav Tengler said, I want to tell you what happened afterwards. And so starting in 1986, the chief rabbinate of Israel decided to adopt the cessation of respiration in the context of brain damage, so what's called respiratory brain death. That was essentially what's called brainstem death. That was determined to be death, and transplants were allowed. So that's 1986. In 1991, Rob Tendler was the head of the bioethics committee for the RCA, and they adopted a healthcare proxy that stated that brain death was death and you could donate organs, and there's an option on their healthcare proxy. And so what happened is that there was a lot of, and both of these positions happened because of reliance on Rav Tendler and Rav Moshe Feinstein. And there was a lot of pushback and a lot of criticism, both of Rav Tendler and of Rav Moshe Feinstein's positions. Rav Moshe Feinstein Saul died, I think, in 1984 or 1985. So Rav Feinstein already was unfortunately dead, and Rav Tendler was accused of all sorts of different things. And what I want to go over a little bit is what he was accused of, and then when we look at Rav Tendler and Rav Moshe Feinstein, you can decide whether these are valid critiques or not. Okay, so one critique leveled against Rav Tendler is that he was completely dependent on the concept of physiological decapitation. So as I said, this idea of physiological decapitation is based on if the head is detached from the body, the person should be dead. And then the question is, why is that, and what part of detachment is important? You could make a long list of things that would be detached. There's skin, there's muscle, there's spinal cord, there's bone, there's trachea, esophagus. There's a lot of different things that are detached. The critics are going to say that, well, that means that there has to be zero circulation to the brain, and there has to be zero live cells in the brain. And the question is that what Rav Moshe and Rav Tendler meant? That's number one. And the next question is, did Rav Tendler and Rav Moshe define death conceptually as the cessation of brain function? In other words, you can say that I believe the brain, that somebody's dead because the brain has ceased function, because their personhood has stopped and things like that. And that's a concept. Or you can say it's a criteria. I believe that death has occurred because the patient has irreversibly ceased to breathe and is no longer moving. It just so happens that cessation of brain function fulfills this particular concept. Okay, so the question is, what is their concept and what is their criteria? They're also going to claim that in the tshuva we're going to read very soon, that Rav Moshe was referring to patients without a heartbeat. Okay, so we're going to read this tshuva and let's decide, is it reasonable to think that this patient did not have a heartbeat, or that he was referring to patients who are terminally ill but not dead? In other words, he wasn't declaring them dead, he was just saying that they were terminally ill. Okay, so we're going to go a little bit out of order. This is the JAMA article that I referred to, Rav Tendler wrote in 1977 with others. And basically he said that total destruction of the brain constitutes a determination of death that is not in conflict with Orthodox Jewish law. This was written with some Catholic theologians and other scientists. So he's not using a whole lot of halakhic terminology, but we get an idea of what he's talking about. So he included the specifics to the Harvard criteria that we talked about. In other words, no brainstem function, no breathing. And then he said, complete destruction of the brain can be considered physiologic decapitation and thus a determinant per se of death of the person. Loss of the ability to breathe spontaneously is a crucial criterion for determining whether complete destruction of the brain has occurred. So it seems that he's focusing on this idea of physiologic decapitation, but he's also talking about cessation of respiration. He also continued to write, spontaneous respiration is an indicator of the living state. So breathing automatically means that you're alive, but it cannot be considered definition because a respirator patient whose sole defect is paralysis of the motor neurons of respiration is alive. In other words, somebody with, this is one of the critiques, somebody who has polio, for example, who can't breathe is otherwise functioning and nobody would consider them to be dead. Okay, so to define death in biblical terms, loss of respiration must be combined with other more obvious evidence of the non-living state. Such evidence would be provided by the criteria that allow a physician to determine that complete and irreversible destruction of the brain or physiological decapitation has occurred. So now again, he's talking about respiration, but also about physiological decapitation and also complete and irreversible destruction of the brain. So it sounds like he's combining both of them, but he has a pretty significant emphasis on this idea of physiological decapitation. And finally, he rejects the idea of cerebral death. So just losing consciousness should not mean that you're dead. And then skip around a little bit. Brain death is only professional jargon to describe a patient who exhibits a permanent loss of signs of life, such as spontaneous movement and responsivity, and has permanently lost the ability to breathe spontaneously. So here, he's not talking about physiologic decapitation. He's talking about loss of breathing and looking like you're dead, in other words, not moving, okay, which would fit with just an idea of brainstem death. Okay, and the only time he actually quotes Ralph Feinstein in this particular article is that once death of the person has occurred and can be determined, there's no biblical obligation to maintain treatment or artificial support for the corpse. Thus, according to Rav Moshe Feinstein, there is no religious imperative to continue to use a respirator to inflate and deflate the lungs and thus maintain the cellular bioviability of other organs. Okay, so this is what Rav Moshe Tendler wrote in 1977. We see a combination of what will eventually become brainstem death, which is not breathing and no brain function that is obvious. But we also see this emphasis on an idea of physiologic decapitation, which he is linking to complete destruction of the brain. Okay, we have to go back now. And this is what's Practical Medical Halakha. This was reprinted in 1990, but this is the 1980 edition. And this is the halakhic bulletin that was originally a monthly formal responsum to halakhic questions of interest to the members of the Raphael Society of the Organization of Orthodox Jewish Scientists. And basically there were individual responsa compiled for publication. And in the introduction, they write, calls for assistance in dealing with ethical and moral issues are met in a clear, definitive fashion with halakhic responsa that are intended to be helpful in a direct, practical way. The terminology identify them as solely for professional readership. So this is for doctors from, you'll see, Rav Moshe Feinstein, to people asking a specific shaila halakha l'maasa, what should you do? It is not written for other, necessarily specifically to other rabbis, although that many of the members were rabbis. This is two doctors who know what they're talking about, know the medical terminology. Okay, these are issues as first aid measures. And what was the role of Rav Moshe here? Because of the far-reaching significance of many of these halakhic decisions, they were submitted to Hagaon Moshe Feinstein for review. The language and analyses, however, are those of the authors who bear responsibility for the accuracy. And Rav Moshe Tendler was the editor, so he wrote that. And in addition, in this book, a recent responsum on the definition of death and on human experimentation by Rav Moshe Feinstein has also been included. Okay, so this is, as far as I can tell, the original source of Rav Moshe's Feinstein's Tshuva on brain death, and which turns out to be Igrot Moshe Yoredeya 132, if I remember correctly. We'll see. But it was initially not just published in his Igrot Moshe. This was written for doctors, the Raphael Society, Halakha L'maasa. Okay, but before we get there, remember there's a separate tshuva from Rav Moshe, but also these like short snippets that were reviewed by Rev Moshe on different topics, and the book is full of short paragraphs, what to do for this, what to do for that, Shabbat, lots of other things. And so in the short snippet, separate from Rav Moshe's Tshuva, it says, the absence of spontaneous respiration and absence of palpable pulse are the cardinal signs for ascertaining death. So here, it seems like we're going in circulation and breathing. However, cerebral death, a flat EEG, remember, we don't want just loss of personhood, so that's not death. Totals, and the italics I think are in the paper, I'm pretty sure. Total cessation of all brain function as determined by the Harvard criteria and radioisotope confirmation that the brainstem is not being perfused is absolute evidence that death has occurred. This is reviewed according to the introduction by Rav Moshe Feinstein. It's right there as a tshuva in this book. The book then goes on and has Rav Moshe Feinstein's Tshuva in Hebrew and also an abstract by Rav Tendler. So Rav Tendler gives this abstract. So a patient presents with clinical signs of death, no signs of life such as movement or response to stimuli. So that it fits with somebody who's lost their brainstem reflexes. The total cessation of independent respiration is an absolute proof that death has occurred. And he says you have to wait a certain amount of time to make sure that the breathing has stopped and that there isn't reversal. But so this fits basically perfectly with our idea of brainstem death. They're not moving, they're not breathing, we know it's irreversible. If such a, and then he gives criteria of how to do it, because you don't want to basically essentially take somebody off a breathing machine and then check necessarily, because if they were alive, then you took them off of breathing unnecessarily. So he says you have to wait until you have to service the machine to do other things. But the concept is there very clearly. And then he goes on and says the above refers to a patient who has been deteriorating and then suffers respiratory collapse. Accident or trauma cases can experience cessation of respiration that is temporary and reversible, and therefore more stringent proof is required. So when I read this, I thought this was somewhat odd, because in my experience 20 years later, trauma patients were very easy to diagnose as being dead. But the difference is CT scans, which is what we use to see what's going on inside the brain, were very in their infancy back then and weren't available. So with their tests, it was very difficult to decide if the trauma patients were alive or not. And 20 years later, it was easy for us to decide if trauma patients looked like they were going to be dead or not. It was much more difficult for the other patients. So it's interesting, again, how technology changes how we view things. But regardless, what Moshe says is that if you're unsure from the testing, then you have to do an additional test to decide. And then you have to do a test to see if there's lysis of the brain cells. So essentially they're gonna wind up mandating a nuclear flow blood flow test to see if there's circulation to the brain. And also injection of toxic substances. So some people are poisoning, this can mimic the loss of brain function. So you have to be very careful with those patients. And if you look at criteria from like the American Academy of Neurology or other societies, their ideas of and declarations of what needs to be done look a lot like this. It says rule out other toxic measures. If the patient has, there's any question about whether they've irreversibly lost function, you need to wait 24 hours and do other tests. So this looks a lot like what medical societies were putting out then and subsequently. Yeah.
The toxic substances, maybe this accident trauma, what you said 24 hours, like what's the window, what's the longest window that someone's ever gone from really appearing to have brainstem death to?
I think the question you're asking is, we do tests. Somebody looks like they might have cessation of neurologic function. And so we do tests. We test to see if their pupils react to the gag function, are they breathing, and things like that. And then if we see signs of function, then they're clearly alive. If we see that they haven't lost function, we see that they have lost function, we have to decide, is this reversible or not? So we know the things that are reversible. So for example, if you have low blood pressure, if you have hypothermia. So for example, there's cases of people who've been frozen and then they're found completely unmoving, even their heart has stopped, and then they warm up, you know, after 24 hours or whatever. And so there are unusual cases. So it's not one specific criteria. It's, we know what things to look for. And nowadays we have really good tests where we can do MRI scans, and there's sophisticated MRI scans to see how, if there's function, we can see a blood flow. There's many different ways to see blood flow. There's many ways to see function. So in most cases, it's very clear. In some cases, it's not. You know, one other reversible problem is, for example, if somebody has increased pressure in their brain, so they don't have blood flow to the brain, if we do an emergency surgery in enough time, quickly enough, we can get the pressure off, and then they can get blood flow back, and they can get function back. So there's, nowadays we have a good idea of how long we need to wait for whatever problem, and most of the time, it's very clear, yes, they've lost it, and we just need to confirm it, or we're not sure, and we just need to wait and see. And there's lots of confirmatory tests to be done, if necessary. Okay, so in addition to Rav Moshe's tshuva, Rav Tendler had his comments. And so Rav Tendler's comments is that halacha recognizes that death occurs before all the organs cease to function. Okay, so things can stop and you can still have function in an organ, but it's not human life. And that halacha defines death as an organismal phenomenon, disassociation of the correlative or coordinating activities of the body. He quotes the Gemara in Gittin about the throat slit. And he writes, the continuing beating of the heart is of no halachic import. Cessation of brain blood flow is invariably accompanied by signs of brain cell lysis. So we know some, that's most of the time, but occasionally not. And then Rav Moshe Feinstein is firmly of the opinion that the sole criterion of death in a patient who gives the clinical impression of death, and he quotes a Rashi, is cessation of spontaneous respiration. Any other definition is contrary to the halachic precedent and truth stated above. A patient who meets Harvard criteria is dead. And then he says that, interestingly, Rav Moshe didn't really want to mandate the blood flow test, but Rav Tendler thought it was important to mandate it to make sure that there were not erroneous determinations. Okay, so Rav Moshe was fine with just clinical observation of no movement and irreversible cessation of respiration. Okay, even more interesting, if doubt exists, is again Rav Tendler's comments on Rav Moshe. If doubt exists, the blood flow studies are indicated, and we might get to a point where we can do blood flow studies and see that just the medulla is the bottom part of the brainstem that controls consciousness and respiration. So if we see just the medulla isn't working, then that would be death. Okay, so here it looks like brainstem death with cessation of breathing. And it doesn't really look like whole brain or every cell. You know, sometimes it gets mentioned, sometimes not, but that doesn't seem to be the major thrust. Okay, and there's nowhere here mention of physiologic decapitation, as best I can tell. Okay, so remember, we saw, this is from 1976, we saw in 1977, Rav Tendler mentioned physiologic decapitation. Okay, and so there are other writings by Rav Tendler in the medical journals. I'm just gonna skip around. And then in 1989, Rav Tendler and Fred Rosner wrote an article on brain death. Again, this is after Rav Moshe Feinstein has died. And this was a edition of the Halacha, Journal of Halacha and Contemporary Society. It had this article, it had Halacha, an article by Rav Schachter, it had an article by Rav Aaron Soloveitchik. And here, what they write is, the brain and brainstem control bodily functions. Irreversible total cessation of all brain function is death. And for our purposes, based on the position of Moshe Feinstein, Rav Tendler introduced the concept of physiological decapitation as an acceptable definition of death, even if cardiac function has not ceased. Rav Moshe Feinstein is of the opinion that the criterion of death in a patient who gives the clinical impression of death is the cessation of spontaneous respiration. So here we have a little bit of nuance between Rav Feinstein and Rav Tendler. It seems that originally they were both very similar, And it looks like Rob Tendler added on the physiologic decapitation part. I'm not exactly sure why. Actually, I'll get to that. Okay, so summary so far, Rav Moshe says, death is when a patient looks dead and is irreversibly apneic. Apnea means not being able to breathe. Blood flow study is not needed for certainty. Rav Tendler in his 1976 comments mirrors Rav Moshe. And all the evidence points to Rav Moshe knowing exactly what Rav Tendler was writing. It's right there. Later, Rav Tendler added the concept of physiologic decapitation. That's what it appears from this analysis of the sources. One understanding of deep physiologic decapitation requires death of all the cells in the brain, okay? But that's not necessarily what Rav Tendler or Moshe thought. And also, remember, we revise our concepts sometimes as science changes. And so sometimes, so a lot of studies show that not every single cell in the brain was dead. And so at that point, you have to decide, is that knock out the idea of physiologic decapitation, or does physiologic decapitation mandate that every cell be dead? And so if you can interpret it a number of different ways. So Rav Bleich, there's a controversy about what this tshuva meant. And so unfortunately, sometimes you can't go by what's in the tshuva, you have to go by what people said about the tshuva. And so Rav J. David Bleich in 1977 wrote, in the spring of 1976, so just 1 year later, a short statement authored by Rav Moshe Feinstein, dated ER, it's actually Hey ER, 5736, dealing with the criteria of death, according to Jewish law, was circulated by the Raphael Society. Accompanying the document was a statement by Rav Moses Tendler going somewhat beyond the position of Rabbi Feinstein. As best as I can tell, I haven't been able to find the original documents, but as best as I can tell, what I showed you in Practical Medical Halacha, first edition, is these statements that Rav Bleich is referencing. Just so you know, if you look at the second edition, they've replaced the brain death part. Okay, so what does Rav Bleich say? Rabbi Feinstein opines that total irreversible cessation of independent respiratory activity is sufficient to establish that death has occurred, yet just the practical problem of how to do it. trauma requires radioisotope scanning only as confirmatory evidence of the irreversible nature. Okay, so absence of respiration may not be accepted as conclusive in case of accident or trauma because it might be reversible. Okay, so the scanning is just to determine irreversibility. It's not a criteria. It's not, you don't have to scan to look for every cell being dead. It's just to be, you need to have some reason to decide it's irreversible. If you can decide it's irreversible on clinical grounds, it looks like he's fine. If you can't, then you need a scan that shows certain things. Okay? And Rav Bleich is not a proponent of this, and so he had...
That was the Tendler's explanation of Rav Feinstein, that last slide.
No, this last slide is, this is Rabbi Bleich. Where's my backspace?
Just the arrows.
So this is Rabbi Bleich writing about Rav Moshe Feinstein and Rav Tendler.
Okay,
so a year later, so very contemporaneous, this is what, so he's essentially repeating what is in the tshuva, the plain meaning of the tshuva.
Right.
Okay.
So this is, he's not saying that this isn't too far. This is Rav Feinstein, and now he's going to say where he thinks Rav Tendler went too far?
No, he's not going to say, he's not really going to say a whole lot about Rav Tendler,
okay.
But he's going to push back against Rav Feinstein.
Okay.
The big controversy is people claim that there's an uncertainty about what Moshe Feinstein said.
Right.
What I'm showing here is that there is no uncertainty. Rav Moshe wrote something. Rav Tendler confirmed it. Rav Bleich, a year later, confirmed it. Rav Bleich is later going to walk this back. Okay? But he hasn't yet. He's not only going to walk it back, he's going to walk back his statement here. Okay. So the critique is important because it tells you what he's unhappy about. Rabbi Feinstein understands this so he's worried that number one, it contradicts some of Rav Moshe's tshuvot on heart transplants. Rav Moshe wrote two tshuvot on heart transplants. One was early on, one was in 1978, which is 2 years after this. And essentially he wrote that it's murder of the both the donor and the recipient. And so people are going to say, well, if he wrote that it's murder of the donor and the recipient, then he couldn't have believed that in brain death, because you have to be brain dead in order to harvest an organ. We will show you that that's not an incorrect, that's an, is an incorrect understanding. He also says that Rav Feinstein, as opposed to his responsum igrot Moshe, so he's trying to kind of take all of Rav Moshe's tshuva together and force an understanding on them. He does not take cognizant of spontaneous cardiac activity as an indicator of life. And he contradicts Rav Black's understanding of different sources. But essentially he's saying Rav Moshe does not think that spontaneous heart function is life. And he's not happy about it, but he's admitting that that is Rav Moshe's position. Okay, later on people are going to say he didn't say it, but Rav Black here is clearly saying that's what Rav Moshe meant. Okay, so Rav Black admits here that Rav Moshe held that cardiac function does not indicate life. Okay. Rav Feinstein is firm in his opinion that the irreversible cessation of spontaneous respiration is halachically both a necessary and sufficient condition for death. And then again, he goes on to about the confirmation studies and to confirm that the concept that cessation of consciousness and things like that is not what Rav Moshe meant. And Rav Moshe didn't mean that. So it's not a critique. He's just, he's trying to, sometimes you'll see the critics are trying to put Rav Moshe or Rav Tendler into the camp of saying that the brain is the most important thing, but neither one of them has said that, so he's basically setting up a little bit of a straw argument and pushing back against it, okay? Neither Rav Moshe nor Rav Tendler claim that a person is dead because their brain died. They're dead because they don't move and are irreversibly apneic. It just so happens that those who have lost brain function fulfill those criteria, okay? So Rav Black basically is setting up a little bit of a straw person, then pushing back against it. Okay. So then what he does is Rav Tendler is he's prepared at least hypothetically to accept additional criteria. And he mentioned the blood flow to the medulla and that Rav Tendler endorsed the Harvard criteria. Again, this was also in that short tshuva that according to the introduction was reviewed by Rav Moshe. And he seems to equate Rav Tendler with physiologic decapitation. And he also points out what we're going to see later is a major issue, if you, that might be an issue, is not every cell in the brain is dead when you don't have, when you have absence of brain blood flow tests, okay? So the big controversy started in 1986 and onward. I will go, we'll just go skip through this, but there are other sources that are before 1986. There's a tshuva from the reform movement that confirms the understanding that Rav Moshe held that the brainstem death was death. This is another analysis from Professor Rosner. So Rav Tendler claims that no one questioned his reports of Rav Moshe until after Moshe died. As best as I can tell, that's accurate. I haven't read absolutely every single thing. There's tons of articles and lots of them get repeated, but as far as I can tell, that is accurate. And again, in 1986, the chief rabbinate adopted cessation of brainstem function as death. And then the Rabbinical Council of America voted to accept brainstem death as halachic death and supported organization as an option in their healthcare proxy. And so this, what started as maybe just a little responsa in a corner of the world, became a very big deal because it was affecting public policy and people pushed back. So again, the most serious claim is that Rav Tendler is misrepresenting Rav Moshe. And Rav Tendler actually has a great article, it's available on Safaria, that goes through all the people who opposed him and why. If you want, if the, in the journal Asia, the Israeli medical journal, there's pages and pages and pages of back and forth. There's the Jewish Review in 1989 and 1990 that has a back and forth between Rav Tendler and Rav Bleich. The Jewish Observer from the Aguda. So there's lots of back and forth of people accusing Rav Tendler of lots of different things. And so the critiques are he misrepresented the position of Rav Moshe. And again, there were changes in medical understanding. And the question is his addition of physiological decapitation a major change or just something that this happens to fit? We'll just add this in. And he actually says that Rav Moshe said that it fits with it's tantamount, is what he said. Rav Moshe told him that it's tantamount to physiologic decapitation. Okay, so Rav Bleich in 1989 critiqued Rav Moshe again. Interestingly, he never mentions his understanding of Rav Moshe from 1977. Okay, and again, he accepted neurologic criteria of death. Again, that's a straw argument. Rav Moshe Feinstein, his opinion was irreversible cessation of breathing when you weren't moving. It's not necessarily neurologic, just happens to be neurologic. Okay, and again, the whole issue with heart transplantation. Okay, and then he tries to, before he said, remember, Rav Feinstein doesn't take cognizant of heart function. And then he redoes some of Rav Moshe's other tshuvot so that these comments certainly reflect a clear recognition that the primary vital force in the human organism is the beating heart. Which again is not consistent with Rav Moshe's tshuva and his understanding of Rav Moshe's tshuva in 1977. In 1991, Rav Bleich wrote one more article. It's in his book, Time of Death. And he addresses his 1977 article, and he says, Rav Feinstein's position was misrepresenting during his own lifetime. He claims that Rav Feinstein's original position regarding heart transplants was a chazak. In other words, if Rav Feinstein paskened that death, a heart transplant was the murder of the recipient and the donor, then he can't change it. He needs like a Beit Din and witnesses and other things like that. And then he had his analysis that he said. He said, well, it's not the determining time of death. He was just talking about criteria for withholding treatment of the terminally ill, which you can just evaluate on your own, the merits on your own. But just so you know, Rav Moshe has other tshuvot on goseis, which somebody who was terminally ill would be considered goseis. And he's very clear you cannot take a ventilator off of somebody who's a goseis. So it doesn't fit with Rav Moshe's. Even if you want to assume that his tshuva in Yoredeya 132 was related to somebody terminally ill, it doesn't fit with Rav Moshe's concept of goseis and what you can or can't do for a goseis. And then he writes about persons, his idea and understanding fits with persons who discussed it with him. And it doesn't appear that Rav Bleich had personal information about it. At least he doesn't bring anything. He refers to other people. So, you know, Rav Tendler writes, I talked to Rav Moshe. We talked about this. We went to see patients. I actually had the opportunity to talk to Fred Rosner a few weeks ago. And he said, yes, Rav Tendler and Rav Moshe and I went to the hospital to see patients. We went to the mortuary to see patients. So Rav Tendler was there. Rav Tendler was there, and he has not just what Rav Moshe wrote, but personal experience. Rav Bleich is, as far as I can tell, writing his own analysis of the tshuvot. Rav Avraham gave information to Rav Shlomo Zalman Auerbach, and Rav Shlomo Zalman Auerbach said, well, you know, that isotope test is a chumrah, you don't have to do it, which is, they agree, but they said, their understanding is that they're only to be able to remove a ventilator, it doesn't mean for transplant. Somebody said, well, you know, that tshuva that Rav Moshe wrote is patients who have no heart function. So in order to do a blood flow study, you have to have heart function or the blood flow is not going to go anywhere. But there is an opinion that Yoredeya 132 was written regarding patients with no heart function or people who required heart assistance. The Aguda claimed that Rav Moshe changed things. It was interesting how the Aguda was writing about the RCA, and they used scare quotes that the RCA has now purported to Paskin and offered the following Torah perspective. And these are quotes that Rav Zweibel put in his article to show his great respect for the RCA and for Rav Feinstein. And again, arguing that Rav Tendler is not being honest about his father-in-law's tshuvot. Okay. So very briefly, because I don't want to go too far over time, what about this idea that the donor and the recipient are murdered in a heart transplant. So number one is the first Juva was before the brain death criteria. And so people weren't thinking about, remember, the whole body versus parts. They weren't really thinking of that in great detail. Number two, there was a moratorium on heart transplants at that time because nobody was surviving because this was before cyclosporin. Number three, Professor Fred Rosner talked to Rev Moshe Feinstein about his ideas of heart transplant. And so there's a book, Heart and Other Modern Medicine, Jewish Law in 1972 by Fred Rosner. And also NCSY used to publish Science and Torah books. It's amazing to find out in 1970, there's a great book with addresses all sorts of science and Torah issues. And Professor Rosner has an article there. So a personal interview by this writer, as well as careful reading of Feinstein's lengthy response on the subject of heart transplant, discloses the following. If the donor is absolutely and positively dead by all medical and Jewish legal criteria, then no murder of the donor would be involved, and the removal of his heart or other organ to save another human life would be permitted. So this is a theoretical that Moshe is leaving open the door for a determination of death that would involve the transplantation of a heart. And so he's clearly not stating that every single heart transplant is murder here. It's just that under the circumstances of 1968, 1969, it practically was. And in his book for NCSY, concerning the recipient, you know, we need to get better. But right now, the chance of success are minuscule. The major concern of most, if not all, of the rabbis attempting to give legal rulings is the establishing of the death of the donor. This is the problem that the medical and legal professions are now wrestling with. So it's a work in progress. It's not a definite, here's the pshat. It's a work in progress. And of course, before they figure out whether and how to decide someone's death, they're going to say, don't do it until we can figure out how to do it. Even Rav Moshe Feinstein and Rav Yitzchak Yaakov Weiss, who votes the most stringent opposition, might also agree under conditions when you figure out how to do it, and if it can. Okay, so the Rabbinical Council of America in 2009 wrote a paper that I got involved in. And basically, again, the same critiques. Some have suggested that Yoredeath 132, the heart is also not beating in this responsa. No, it's not. This approach might be suggested, it could be speaking of an accident victim who's receiving mechanical support for both respiration and cardiac activity. I am not sure where they see that in that particular tshuva. Rav Feinstein reaffirmed that heart transplants were usher. Yes, he did. He didn't want them to go on. It really doesn't have anything to do with his determinations of death. So you can see how these misunderstandings of Rav Moshe and Rav Tendler have been perpetuated and unfortunately have been in the mainstream. People send me like shiurim from Reitz, YU Torah, and very rarely does Rav Moshe and Rav Tendler get a fair hearing. It's sad. We're going to skip all this. Okay, so basically the people who critique Rav Moshe and Rav Tendler don't give an option. Okay, so how else are you going to define life? We decided that circulation doesn't work because you can have circulation to somebody who's alive, you can have circulation to a body that's dead. So Rav Bleich introduced the idea of vital motion. Again, it took him some time. Rav Schachter has a theory that there's three organs that define life, Evarim Shen and Nishamat Tliyaba, the heart, the liver, and the brain. But they don't make a whole lot of sense, and I'm going to show you why. Essentially, though, to conclude, before I give you one final example, death is the irreversible cessation of breathing in the context of something more. And it's very clear that the something more doesn't have to be heart function. And according to Rav Moshe, and I think Rav Tendler as well, it's like no observable neurologic function. So it's brainstem death. Rav Tendler added in physiologic decapitation because it kind of looks like it, but it's not as a criteria that all the criteria strict, you know, exactly what physiologic decapitation looks like has to be fulfilled. It's just like this looks like it. And so it's a way to think about it. But there's obviously he left a lot of way of openings for different interpretations, but I think the fundamental understanding of Rav Moshe is very clear. Okay, so one last case. In 1977, there was twins born in Philadelphia, and they were conjoined. So they shared one six-chamber heart, two heads, I think four arms, four legs, I think, but they were conjoined, okay? And they determined that if they remained joined, they would both die because there wasn't enough heart function for both of them. They were baby A and baby B, and they determined that if they separated them, only baby B could survive, so unfortunately baby A would die. But if they remained together, they would both die. And so C. Everett Koop actually was the surgeon, later the Surgeon General, and they were from couple who had the babies, and it was a great Kiddush Hashem. There were many articles written, and C. Everett Koop was quoted as, "I don't know what to do. There's an old sage in the Lower East Side. He's going to tell me what to do, and when he tells me what to do, then I'll know." And he was referring to Rav Moshe Feinstein. And Rav Tendler apparently visited the hospital, talked to the doctors. They had many conferences, and Rav Tendler played a very integral part in figuring out what to do. Ultimately, they were separated by C. Everett Koop. Well, baby A unfortunately died. Baby B unfortunately died 3 months later from infection. Okay, but here's an example of, and this is not the exact baby A and B, but here we have two heads, let's say one heart and a liver, and everybody agrees that this is two people, but the question is, why is it two people? So if we say that brainstem function determines life, then it's easy to say it's two people. If you say it's circulation, well, there's only one heart, so you could say maybe just one person. If you say that there's vital motion, how do you decide when vital motion is one person, when vital motion is two people, when three people? If you say that it's dependent on a heart, a liver, and a brain, well, what happens if you don't have three whole sets, two whole sets? And so these other non-neurologic or non-brainstem definitions of life fail to give cogent answers to these sorts of situations, and they're still depending on this old idea of total body unity. And I think this is one of the things that drove Rav Tendler crazy, that the people who were critiquing him did not provide solid, coherent alternatives to what he was suggesting, in addition to their critiques and accusations. Okay, so there's a famous Ashley and Brittany Hensel. Okay, so how are we going to determine life and death? That's how we're going to do it. We're going to listen to Rav Moshe. We're going to listen to Rav Tendler. We're going to acknowledge that there is some uncertainty in what Rav Tendler was holding and the idea of physiologic decapitation. But ultimately, what Rav Moshe held is clear and incontrovertible, and that sensation of brainstem function, basically respiration in the context of neurologic dysfunction, is death. And we should respect Rav Tendler. He's a Zohar Baruch Hu. Thank you for being here. Questions?
Does the chair look just like the Nachamina, how this might show up in not an extreme case of conjoined twins, but in more daily life, and why it would be so important to understand and practice or Tendler is?
Oh, sure. So in major medical centers, there are people who show up who had horrible car accidents or had huge strokes, and they lose brain function. And we test them, basically we do the Harvard criteria updated, and we see that there's no sign of any brainstem function. We do blood flow tests and see that as best as within the limits of that test, there's no flow to the brain. And we know there were, early on, there were many patients that were followed until the heart stopped. And so we know that if we support that body as long as we can, there will never be any return of brain function. They will never breathe again on their own. And so the question is, how do we address these patients? And do we consider them to be dead? Do we consider them to be alive? And there's a debate in the bioethical literature, huge debate, and there's also a halachic debate. But the major nafkamina is, number one, can you take organs out of a person who's alive? No. Can you take organs out of a person who's dead? Yes. And so it's a major implication for organ donation. It's also a major implication for
those organs would be very valuable.
Yeah, so there's every day many people die because of liver failure, heart failure, and kidney failure because they don't have an organ. And so organ transplantation is a hugely life-saving technology, and it's gotten extremely safe. I mean, there still obviously are significant risks, but it is a life-saving technology. And so if we claim that no one is ever able to donate organs, then all those people, until we get those pig kidneys going, all those people are just going to die.
And also I'm imagining, you know, just the prospect of sustaining a body with circulation for...
Right. So that was early on. So, right. So...
pain and the expense and the...
So early on, one of the reasons... So there's a big debate whether the idea of brain death started because of transplantation, but there's... So there's an argument on that side. There's also an argument that they were finding that they had patients, an ICU was filled with patients who were on breathing machines who had no sign of function. And should we consider these people to be dead or not? And that's what started in like the late 1950s. And so that is a huge expense. Not that expense should be a major issue in deciding life and death matters.
It's needle-made.
Right. So 100%. 100%. So if the patient is dead, it is needle-made. And so we do have obligations.
And it's terrible for the family, you know, in this limbo for, you could keep a body circulating with blood for how long in that situation?
So theoretically, you should be able to keep them going forever. But practically, usually the heart stops within a few days to a few weeks. There's a neurologist, Alan Schumann, collected as many cases as he could in 1995 of long-term survival of the body after the patient had died. There's one outstanding case where, and so he found some were like weeks and months, and there's every once in a while there's a case in the news of a woman who's pregnant and becomes unfortunately brain dead, and they support the body until the fetus is old enough to survive outside the womb. And so obviously in those cases they do everything they can to go as long as possible. So sometimes it's possible to go longer, sometimes it's not. There's data that shows we can have an idea based on a couple different factors, but most of the time you can't support the body for more than a few days a week. But you know, as we get better, and you know, the heart is going to beat on its own, so as we get better, we should be able to support them for longer and longer.
Which is not good.
If they're dead, no, 100%.
And then it also goes back a little bit to what Dr. Stadler talked about at the very beginning. He's not a murderer, and that's important, because I think, I haven't been around this in many, many years, but there are situations where families will say, but they're breathing and their heart is beating, what do you mean they're dead? You have to be able to tell them with certainty that they are.
Well, they're on the breathing machine.
They're breathing machine. Okay. Right. But it's so confusing because, you know, yeah, Jewish law says we got to keep them alive, you know, that idea in life and do all the interventions. And it's, you know, these are confusing topics for people.
Right. It is unfortunately complex, and unfortunately people have made it more complicated than it needs to be. But that's why it's important for everybody to have the facts.
Gotta learn this. Yeah.